Warning, World War II.
Hit!
These are Hollywood's war heroes in action. With a little help from special effects, they can sink them, blast them, or shoot them down. And thanks to Hollywood, it looks just like the real thing. Our movie heroes fight the red-blooded, two-fisted, good fight any place, anywhere, from the halls of Montezuma to the sands of Iwo Jima. Sometimes heroes make mistakes. Sometimes they're just plain lucky. Seems like they're always saying
goodbye
to the girls they love. They get shot at, captured, kissed, beaten, and bandaged. And still, they keep coming back for more. Heroes do the impossible, because that's what they're there for. Like the Marine Corps, Hollywood has always looked for a few good men. Women. It's not easy being a movie war hero. But somebody's got to do it. Watch as we slug it out with them in the trenches and in the clinches.
All real Americans love the sting of battle.
I wonder how a degenerated person like that could have reached a position of responsibility in the Army Medical Corps.
He was drafted.
Heroes have been popping up in war movies as long as Hollywood's been making them. Hollywood's heroes are usually young, smart, handsome, lovable, beautiful, athletic, modest, brave, stubborn, rough, tough, emotional, fearless, and able to make long leaps in a single bound. If the description makes our movie heroes sound a bit like Superman, it's not a coincidence. They are. But there's a good reason. You wouldn't have it any other way.
Sir, this is Private Elliott, Opana Point. There's a large formation of planes coming in from the north, 140 miles, 3 degrees east.
Yeah? Well, don't worry about it.
It just came over from Washington. The jets have attacked Pearl Harbor.
Most American families found out about Pearl Harbor the way Dan Daly's movie family did. Hollywood entered the war at the same instant, its newsreel cameramen on the scene shooting history-making film. Years later, Hollywood would use that film as a guide in making Tora, 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 the true story of that attack. It cost Hollywood $25 million to make this movie. 25 times what it cost the Japanese for the actual attack. Many kinds of real heroes were born during the opening moments of that sneak raid. Lady pilot Cornelia Fort was in the air and could have been a heroine if she had just had a radio in her plane to warn of the attack. And
There were frustrated heroes like Major Truman Landon leading a flight of unarmed B-17s in from the mainland.
What a way to fly into a war, unarmed and out of gas.
There were first-time heroes like Lieutenants Welch and Taylor, first American pilots to down enemy planes. And the unsung heroes who grabbed whatever was at hand and fought back hard.
What are you doing here?
I don't like clouds, sir.
It didn't take Hollywood long to declare war, too, with a barrage of movies featuring what everybody needed to see, the all-American hero in action. Dana Andrews was the sub-captain in Crash Dive. In the films made just after Pearl Harbor, the hero was a sort of indestructible Iron Man, taking punishment that would flatten ordinary mortals.
What is it, Jack?
It's only a flesh wound, sir.
Good people of the Philippines, the Emperor of Japan is your best friend. His soldiers are your friends.
Lloyd Nolan found out otherwise. In Manila Calling, also filmed during the early stages of World War II, he was the guerrilla hero, supercharging audiences with patriotism.
Come on. Filipinos and Americans, we didn't surrender. We just ran out of soldiers because the soldiers ran out of blood, but we're still in this fight. General MacArthur promised that he'd be back. Be ready for him because he will be back. He never made a date yet that he didn't keep. If you don't believe me, ask Mrs. MacArthur. Yeah, and ask little Arthur MacArthur, too. Can you hear me, America? Send us the guns and tanks and planes. We'll do the job. Another calling. Another calling.
Corregidor has fallen.
Corregidor has fallen.
In movies like The Purple Heart, Hollywood gave us the captive hero. It was based on true accounts of the inhumanities inflicted on pilots seized by the enemy.
General MacArthur abandoned Corregidor when he saw defense was useless. That is clever. You insist on protecting the carrier from which you came when it no longer needs your protection. That is stupid.
General MacArthur had his orders, we have ours. I'm sure he found his orders as difficult to obey as we find ours.
As you wish. Remove the prisoners.
Daryl Zanuck made The Purple Heart under a total news blackout before any official facts on war crimes were released, because he felt Americans needed to be reminded about the importance of the war in the Pacific. Dana Andrews and his fellow actors did just that. Contain actual combat footage. Director Henry Hathaway and a camera crew were aboard a carrier shooting the real thing for use in A Wing and a Prayer.
They're going to be hit.
That same film also gave us a special kind of hero, one who would sacrifice himself to save his buddy.
Flying that plane?
Ensign Cunningham, sir.
In that same movie, another hero was a screen actor who took his Oscar along into combat as a good luck charm. Back in Hollywood, stars like beautiful Jean Tierney were busy christening bombers, along with the wife of our then vice president.
Mrs. Truman tried to christen a bomber, and what a bombardment!
While Mrs. Truman was getting help from a local hero, many of Hollywood's biggest screen names heard the call and joined up. Clark Gable and Robert Montgomery donned real uniforms, along with Jimmy Stewart. And Tyrone Power, who was just finishing up work on Crash Dive, was sworn into the U.S. Marines. But it was in costume on the silver screen that these leading men had their greatest moments.
You two make a break for it. Leave them to me.
Oh, so that's it, huh? A hero to the last. Well, get this. We all go or we all stay.
As the tide of war started to turn more in our favor, movies started making heroes out of ordinary guys, just plain G.I. Joes who had to slug it out foot by agonizing foot. Guadalcanal Diaries heroes were young Marines facing battle for the first time in a movie about our first big Pacific victory. Out there, innocent heroes learn fast. Richard Jekyll was only 16 when he was plucked out of the studio mailroom for this starring role as, yep, an underage Marine.
That's one you taught me, Tojo.
Hey, buddy, what's it like out here?
Pretty rugged, son.
See you guys in Tokyo.
Okay. We'll be there waiting for you.
It took Hollywood 105 days to make Guadalcanal Diary. 10 more days than it took the real Marines to finally capture the island. While those Marines headed for Tokyo, Hollywood's army was heading for Berlin via North Africa.
Rommel, you magnificent director boss!
George, you have performed brilliantly. You are loyal, dedicated. You're one of the best field commanders I've got, but you don't know when to shut up, George. You're a pain in the neck.
One of the most misunderstood heroes of the war was General George S. Patton, who liberated more German-held territory than any other Allied field commander. In this Academy Award-winning film, George C. Scott plays Patton as an extremely complex and driven man, an aggressive leader remembered for an act which turned an adoring public against its hero.
Nothing wrong with him. I won't have some. We're afraid to fight, stinking up this place of honor. We're going back to the front, my friend. You may get shot,
you may get killed, but you're going up to the fighting.
Either that or I'm going to stand you up in front of a firing squad. I ought to shoot you myself. Damn you. Get him out of here. Send him up to the front. You hear me?
Hollywood war isn't always hell. There's time to laugh and time to love, too. Next, funny heroes, anti-heroes, and the women they love.
But this is dreadful. How can I give such news to the Führer? Make peace, you idiot.
Americans love a winner and will not tolerate a loser. Americans play to win all the time. I wouldn't give a hoot in hell for a man who lost and laughed. That's why Americans have never lost and will never lose a war.
The truth is that a soldier has but one function in life, one lone excuse for existence, and that is to carry out the order of his superiors.
Any man with unshined shoes or soiled uniform is going to be skinned.
Oh, this is a sloppy outfit. Discipline, discipline, that's what you need.
If you or any man on this post passes me up again without saluting, even if I'm a block away, you'll wonder what fell on you.
Sergeant, you going to disobey an order in the face of the enemy? You want a court-martial?
No, sir.
All right, then. Get him to the rear.
Sir, this is the rear.
Sabatello, this is an order. Strip.
Well, gentlemen, we have our orders.
Like real heroes, Hollywood heroes have to take orders, no matter where it takes them. Never mind that Robert Taylor is ordered to take Omaha Beach and ends up really attacking Point Dune, California. Where else would you expect Hollywood to make a movie about the D-Day landing on the French coast? In The Longest Day, producer Daryl Zanuck came a little closer. This time, it was the island of Corsica standing in for Normandy. In that film, Zanuck used an all-star cast to portray different actual heroes. Red Buttons plays a paratrooper with bad luck. Meanwhile, back in the Pacific War, Hollywood showed us it would go to any depths to bring us heroic fighting men like the Frogmen. By the time Richard Widmark made this movie, he had already played heroes in 24 other war epics. After the war ended, a different film began to emerge from Hollywood, one which had fallible heroes. Heroes that were more real, more human. In 12 O'Clock High, Gregory Peck finally breaks under the strain of command.
We can't go! Can't send them out there again! Stop them! Stop them! Stop them! We can't take it! Stop them!
Hollywood also began to view our former enemies more sympathetically. Robert Mitchum and Kurt Jurgens are evenly matched heroes on opposite sides in The Enemy Below, with each gradually winning the other's respect until they practically wipe each other out. Two different endings were actually shot for this film, one in which the heroes both lived and one in which they both died. Audiences and critics were glad that Hollywood decided to let both heroes survive. In The Sand Pebbles, shot in Taiwan, Steve McQueen learned to hate war and killing, but hung on to the hero myth.
He's dead. Get her out of here.
Let's all get going.
Somebody's got to slow him up. They'd nail us before we got halfway to the river. And if they get a hold of her, you know what they're going to do to her.
Now go ahead. I'll be around.
One of the funniest satires on war, MASH, Elliot Gould and Donald Sutherland ran roughshod as Army surgeons trying to keep their sanity in the midst of the madness.
What are you two hooligans doing in this hospital?
Ma'am, we are surgeons and we are here to operate. We're just waiting for a starting time.
Well, you can't even go near a patient until Colonel Merrill says it's okay. And he's still out to lunch.
Look, Mother, I want to go to work in 1 hour. We are the pros from Dover and we figure to crack this kid's chest and get out to the golf course before it gets dark. So you go find the gas passer and you have him pre-medicate this patient. Then bring me the latest pictures on him. The ones we saw must be 48 hours old by now. Then call the kitchen and have them rustle us up some lunch. Ham and eggs will be all right. Steak would be even better. And then give me at least one nurse who knows how to work in close without getting her chest in my way.
Oh. How do you want your steak cooked?
Comedy has always been a good way for Hollywood's heroes to deal with some of the tensions of battle.
Nice, ice cream. Wonderful.
Jimmy Cagney shows us one wake-up technique. Dean Martin getting a physical.
Turn your head and cough.
Hello, darling. I love you.
I love you.
I appreciate that, Dewey. Thanks very much, and it's mutual.
No! Would you mind taking that ladder off my foot?
Oh, I'm sorry.
A hero never has trouble meeting girls, and there's no telling where this will take them.
Come on, Sergeant, be sociable for a change. Buy a poor thirsty girl a drink.
Just shut your mouth or I'll belt your teeth down your throat.
You're mine, and you're going to stay mine.
Let go of me. You're hurting. Let's get married.
When?
Tonight.
I've been wanting to ask you that for weeks.
I want us to go someplace and get married.
Now?
Look, honey, I love you. But today? Now, you've been seeing too many war pictures.
But for Hollywood heroes, the time for love is always too short.
Sorry, Charmaine. I can't marry you tonight. I got work to do. And if I never see you again, well, I guess I never see you again. So long, kid.
So long, man.
So long.
I came to say goodbye.
Goodbye and good luck.
So long, Pop.
Goodbye, Sean.
Goodbye, Edward. Please get lost. We're saying goodbye.
Goodbye, Mrs. Abbott.
Goodbye, Major Seville.
It's a lousy war, kid. But it's the only one we've got.
Like the real hero, Hollywood's heroes head off to battle. They've said their farewells and left their loved ones with the thought, the possibility, the fear that they might not be coming back. But they'll be back, because as long as there's a Hollywood, there will always be a hero.
I will be proud to lead you wonderful guys into battle anytime, anywhere.